My name is Christine Drew, and with me is Richard Erdman. We're the co-founders of Syfr Learning, a professional development company. We use art to demonstrate how learning takes place. We integrate the arts with cognitive science to create a set of principles of learning. Today's session is about Van Gogh's work, Starry Night, and his demonstration of some of these principles.
Did you know that Van Gogh did Starry Night twice? Did you know that the second work was the drawing, not the painting? He even considered the painting a study. The obvious conclusion about Van Gogh from these two works is that he was willing to repeat. If we want learning that is durable, it turns out repetition is essential. If we want learning that is flexible, meaning that it can be used in various contexts, variation is necessary. We also observe that within the repetition, Van Gogh has variation. We also know that Van Gogh did these two works a few days apart. He spaced the work over time. Repetition is ineffective when massed in a narrow time block, but incredibly effective when spaced over days and then months. Who knew that studying Van Gogh would be like studying cognitive science?
One of the characteristics of learning that Van Gogh illustrates is a progressive series of variations that increase in complexity and difficulty. One of the things that does keep learners going is the sense of progress. Usually this means from a beginning point towards some kind of end point with symbols of success in between. In Van Gogh's case, there are symbols of success in the form of finished works, even if they are studies and not ultimately a product.
Van Gogh's sense of progress was probably instrumental to his own sensitivities, because selling art was something he just could not do. So an increasing sense of competence probably played a bigger role with Van Gogh than with many other artists. He needed an intrinsic drive of some sort to keep him moving forward, and his repetitions probably show this better than anything.
As you can see, Van Gogh's drawings are becoming increasingly complex. He's using a variety of tools, pencil, chalk, pen and ink, and he's gaining confidence with his subjects as he repeats with variation.
With confidence, Van Gogh now paints with oils. He believes his drawings in oils as being of equivalent value.
To get a better sense of why he viewed drawing and painting as equivalent, look at this drawing. It incorporates black chalk, reed pen, and ink. A reed pen is typically self-made, cut into different widths, and holds about enough ink for a 1/4 to 1/2 inch line. Now, imagine how many touches to the paper are required by a 9x12 drawing or something slightly smaller. There are no do-overs. Unlike an oil painting where you can cover up a mistake with more paint, a mistaken drop of ink requires starting over. A line that is too wide requires starting over. His drawings are incredibly complex and difficult.
All of the works we have seen so far, and most that we will see, are from 1889 when Van Gogh checked himself into St. Paul's Asylum. The wheat fields were outside his window, but Van Gogh had access to other settings and took advantage of them. He interlaced his work on the wheat fields with work on other subjects. He did not work on the wheat fields exclusively, but took time to paint the nearby olive groves or the gardens inside the asylum. Today, this is called interleaving practice. By leaving something you are learning and then coming back to it later, you stretch or challenge yourself. As a result, the learning becomes more durable.
Now look at these two prints. The one on the right is Van Gogh's. The one on the left is a woodblock done by one of Van Gogh's favorite Japanese artists, Hiroshige. The brain automatically creates associations when it can. Association also has value for making memories that stick.
Here we see an example of associations. Van Gogh incorporates Hiroshige's rain into several of his drawings and paintings. He created associations with many of Hiroshige's work. Again, association is an important part of repetition to improve memory.
To have a sense of how Van Gogh concretely demonstrates principles from cognitive science, we might at this point look at creativity and see how it relates to learning. An economist defines something as creative when it is original and of value to a domain of work. Learning is the same. What is learned is original to the learner and also of value.
But learning also has some other characteristics. For something to be learned, one must be able to recall it. Learning requires durability. Then it must be capable of being used in a variety of ways. In other words, learning must be flexible or transferable between multiple contexts and at multiple times.
Van Gogh's own learning is a visible demonstration of Syfr's principles of practice. His progress over time is a testimony to personalized learning. The study of his work helps us answer an important question. When teaching students or learning something new for ourselves, how do we compensate for a brain that really likes to forget?
Van Gogh repeated with variation and association and challenged himself with more difficult work. By doing so, he developed a durable skill. He repeated in a variety of ways, strengthening durability and resulting in learning that he could apply in various contexts. His learning was flexible. He could transfer it. Van Gogh, however, did more than vary his practice. His work was spaced. It was associated with other artists, and it gave him a sense of progress.
You may be wondering now, what has all this got to do with Starry Night? But hang in there. In the end, we will discuss creativity, and our durable and flexible memories will merge.
2 years before Van Gogh did Starry Night, he used two hiroshigis as models and imitated them. One was the bridge we saw earlier, and one was this plum tree. The Japanese structured their paintings or prints horizontally with bands of different colors, created perspective by putting something large and of contrasting color in the front of the print and at the bottom, as was the case with the bridge across almost the entire print, as is the case here, or they put it on the side. The Japanese influence began trickling into Paris in the early 1860s, and by the time of Van Gogh, some 25 years later, it was well known and the influence on Western artists was substantial. By using another work of art as a model, he could experiment with techniques by investigating and improvising. In the process, he accelerates his learning.
Although Van Gogh used the works of many artists as models, Millet was probably his favorite. Millet painted The Sower on the left in 1850, which was the year Van Gogh was born. 31 years later, in 1881, Van Gogh created the work on the right with pencil, ink, and watercolor on paper. He came back to this subject again 5 to 7 years later when he began to experiment with what he learned from the Japanese and other artists. This is an example of Van Gogh's investigation of the use of models by combining what he has learned. Notice the Japanese influence. You see it in the plum tree, the bands of color, the horizontal and diagonal structure of the painting. All of these experiments are done with Millet's content model, The Sower, except this time it is an original by Van Gogh. Van Gogh is a perfect artist for answering the question on acceleration because he borrows from models all the time.
For Van Gogh, the work of many other artists were inspirational and the basis for imitation, improvisation, investigation, innovation, and invention. They also allow a learner to create a framework or a scaffold within which to experiment and predict. Let's take a look at just two other artists and see how they influence Van Gogh with respect to The Sower, but in a different way.
In 1884, Syrah began working on his famous Sunday afternoon on the island of the Grand Jatte. He did over 50 studies of these works, and he influenced many artists at the time, including Van Gogh. Van Gogh saw this experiment with a shortened brushstroke in the works of his friend Paul Signac, represented here by the painting of Sunshine in 1886. This form or school of art became known as pointillism, and Van Gogh was fascinated by this idea of shortening his brushstroke and using color differently with divisionism. Now Van Gogh taps a different set of prior knowledge. He uses what he learned from Syrah, Signac, and Pizarro and shortens his brushstrokes and makes each stroke a distinct color. First, Van Gogh observed a group of artists who were developing a new style of painting, divisionism. Then he simplified the concept down to brushstroke and color. He went back to a previous painting and connected this concept to an old subject to create a brand new work of art. In the classroom, the teacher creates a platform or foundation of knowledge so that the learner can connect new knowledge. When the connections get made, it simplifies the learning and creates a curiosity for more on the part of the student. This begins a process we call observe, connect, simplify.
Van Gogh was a great observer. He selected from his vast array of prior knowledge and used it to determine how he would experiment. In the prior example, he changed the more solid bands of color to the varied color created by the shorter brushstroke, but in the same basic composition. He was investigating, to use a term from models, and improvising in his process of observe, simplify, connect. The way we work to get a brain to learn below the surface. Van Gogh accumulated knowledge and skill along the path of his brief 10-year career. This process of simplifying and connecting is automatic. New observations, information, can be connected to prior knowledge by setting up a knowledge platform, so to speak, in advance of the instruction. In the same manner that Van Gogh sought out the prior knowledge that he wanted to use as he observed what he wanted to paint, in the process, we can create the curiosity needed by the learner to get below the surface. It's like Madeline Hunter's hook, designing practice so that there are finished symbols of success along the learning path sustains attention, just as Van Gogh did by having finished works along the path toward a complete work. He abstracted the essence of the pointillists and used them in his paintings by connecting it to a sewer he had done previously.
Let's watch this develop one more time before returning to Starry Night. In 1854, the United States opened Japan to international trade. While the artists in Paris were quite taken with the Japanese, the reverse was also true. This print by Hiroshige, Night View of the Saromaki Machi, is an example. Hiroshige had adopted the Western technique of narrowing a path or street to create perspective. Louis Anquetin, and we suspect Van Gogh, saw the print. Anquetin painted L'Avenue de Clichy. Van Gogh and Anquetin were friends, and a year later, Van Gogh was working himself on night skies and did his drawing and painting of Café du Place, a café still buzzing in Arles, France. Van Gogh did several night skies while living in Arles, and he was still a year away from Starry Night.
Now for another influence on Starry Night, you should begin to see some connections. In the spring of 1889, Van Gogh did this quick sketch of Saint-Rémy, a village about 5 miles from St. Paul's. Notice the church in the center of the drawing. Van Gogh is about to move this village, transfer it from one setting to another. He is using some more principles of practice that cognitive science would encourage, synthesis and transfer.
The wheat field outside his window was replaced by the village. He even replaced the church in Saint-Rémy with a church he had painted not far from Amsterdam, his home. The cypress tree was moved to the left side of his view, and early one morning he painted Starry Night. A few days later, the drawing followed.
There is no question that Van Gogh learned to be creative. He did not synthesize or transfer. easily or fluently in his early career. And by 1888, when he left Paris and went to Arles to practice on his own and later with Gauguin, he flourished. He became the artist we know today. He nurtured his own creativity by developing the knowledge that he needed. Creativity came to a prepared mind.
Whether Van Gogh knew how to play is questionable, but he created an environment for himself to learn as he chose when he left Paris. At this point in time, he wanted to experiment with his own unique combinations of what he had learned. He wanted to synthesize his knowledge and skill and transfer it to a new setting and to original work. Without question, he assigned value to his work as he went, and by the time he died, he was being recognized by his peers as a major talent. The arts and sciences were fully integrated.
Applying the science of learning, or the study of cognition and practice, improvements of student learning have been dramatic. This is a submission of end-of-week test scores on vocabulary from a history teacher in a middle school.
These are the end-of-week scores on a vocabulary quiz from a third-grade teacher. The arts and sciences of learning were successfully transferred to classroom practice. Learning like an artist is just like learning like a scientist or an engineer. It takes practice with repetition, variation, association, and challenge. It requires observation, synthesis, and transfer. The principles are the same. There is an art and a science to learning.